Hey everybody, today is Tuesday, May 5th. Yesterday was May the 4th. Be with you, Star Wars Day. I totally forgot to mention that in the video that I uploaded. Wow, what a temperature change, huh? Yesterday around like 4 o'clock. Actually, yeah, right around like 3 o'clock was like 70 degrees. And then like 4 o'clock, literally less than an hour later, it probably dropped about a good 25 degrees.
6:30.
Sorry about that. 4 o'clock, it was like 75. Pretty really comfortable. Saturday was really humid, but it was very warm, and it probably dropped about a good 30 degrees come Sunday night around 7 o'clock. It was really interesting. We live on the man-made lake, and you can see like the wind was coming from the southwest all day, and then as soon as like 7 o'clock rolled around, it started coming from the northeast, and it got cold. But it was, it's what you get living in Wisconsin. If we don't like it, we move. So anyway, so we're on chapter 12. We're gonna read chapter 12 and 13 today from Holes. And Stanley was in a second day of digging holes, and he's daydreaming that Derek Dunn, the school bully, wouldn't stand a chance against the people that he's met with at Camp Green Lake. And Mrs. Chen and I were just talking about what an oxymoron Camp Green Lake is. Well, first of all, it's not a camp. Second of all, it's not green. And third of all, it's not even a lake. So, all right, here we go, chapter 12. Again, Stanley was the last one to finish digging. It was late afternoon when he dragged himself back to the compound. This time, he would have accepted a ride on the truck if it was offered. When he got to the tent, he found Mr. Pandansky and the other boys sitting in a circle on the ground. "Welcome, Stanley," said Mr. Pandansky. "Hey, caveman, you get your hole dug?" asked Magnet. He managed to nod. "You spit in it?" asked Squid. He nodded again. "You're right," he said to X-Ray. "The second hole's the hardest." X-Ray shook his head. "The third hole's the hardest," he said. "Come, join our circle," said Mr. Pandansky. Stanley plopped down between Squid and Magnet. He needed to rest up before taking a shower. "We'd been discussing what we want to do with our lives," said Mr. Pandansky. "We're not gonna be at Camp Lake forever. We need to prepare for the day we leave here and join the rest of society." "Hey, that's great, Mom," said Magnet. "They're gonna finally let you out of here?" The other boys laughed. "Okay, Jose," said Mr. Pandansky. "What do you want to do with your life?" I don't know, said Magnet. "You need to think about that," said Mr. Pandansky. "It's important to have goals. Otherwise, you're going to end up right back in jail. What do you like to do?" I don't know, said Magnet. "You must like something," said Mr. Pandansky. "I like animals." "Good," said Mr. Pandansky. "Does anyone know of any jobs that involve animals?" "Veterinarian," said Armpit. "That's right," said Mr. Pandansky. "He could work in a zoo," said Zigzag. "He belongs in the zoo," said Squid. Then he and X-Ray laughed. "How about you, Stanley? Any ideas for Jose?" Stanley sighed. "Animal trainer," he said. "Like for the circus or movies or something like that." "Any of those jobs sound good to you, Jose?" asked Mr. Pandansky. "Yeah, I like what Caveman said about training animals for movies. I think it would be fun to train monkeys." X-Ray laughed. "Don't laugh, Rex," said Mr. Pandansky. "We don't laugh at people's dreams. Someone's gonna have to train monkeys for the movies." "Who are you kidding, Mom?" asked X-Ray. "Magnet's never gonna be a monkey trainer." "You don't know that," said Mr. Pandansky. "I'm not saying it's gonna be easy. Nothing in life is easy. But that's no reason to give up. You'll be surprised what you can accomplish if you set your mind to it. After all, you only have one life. So you should try to make the most of it." Stanley tried to figure out what he'd say if Mr. Pandansky asked him what he wanted to do with his life. He used to think he wanted to work for the FBI, but this didn't seem the appropriate place to mention that. "So far, you've all done a pretty good job at messing up your lives," said Mr. Pandansky. "I know you think you're cool." He looked at Stanley. "So you're caveman now, huh? You like digging holes, that caveman?" Stanley didn't know what to say. "Well, let me tell you something, caveman. You are here on account of one person. If it wasn't for that person, you wouldn't be here digging holes in the hot sun. You know who that person is?" "My no good, dirty, rotten, pig-stealing great-great-grandfather," the other boys howled with laughter. Even Zero smiled. It was the first time Stanley had ever seen Zero smile. He usually had such an angry expression on his face. Now, he had such a huge smile, it almost seemed too big for his face, like the smile on a jack-o'-lantern. "No," said Mr. Pandansky. "That person is you, Stanley. You're the reason you are here. You're responsible for yourself. You messed up your life, and it's up to you to fix it. No one else is going to do it for you, for any of you. Mr. Pendaski looked from one boy to another. You're all special in your own way, he said. You've all got something to offer. You have to think about what you want to do, then do it. Even you, Zero, you're not completely worthless. The smile was now gone from Zero's face. What do you want to do with your life? Mr. Pendaski asked him again. Zero's mouth was shut tight as he glared at Mr. Pendaski's dark eyes seemed to expand. What about it, Zero? Asked Mr. Pendaski. What do you like to do? I like to dig holes. Interesting conversations, huh? All right, chapter 13 is only a few pages. So we're going to continue on. All too soon, Stanley was back out on the lake, sticking his shovel into the dirt. X-Way was right. The third hole was the hardest. So was the fourth hole, and the fifth hole, and the sixth, and the... He dug his shovel into the dirt. After a while, he lost track of the day of the week and how many holes he dug. It all seemed like one big hole, and it would take a year and a half to dig it. He guessed he'd lost at least 5 pounds. He figured that in a year and a half, he'd either be in great physical condition or else dead. He dug his shovel into the dirt. It couldn't always be this hot, he thought. Surely it got cooler in December. Maybe then they froze. He dug his shovel into the dirt. His skin had gotten tougher. It didn't hurt so much to hold the shovel. As he drank from his canteen, he looked up at the sky. A cloud had appeared earlier in the day. It was the first cloud he could remember seeing since coming up to Camp Green Lake. He and the other boys had been watching it all day, hoping it would move in front of the sun. Occasionally, it got close, but it was just teasing them. His hole was now waist deep. He dug his shovel into the dirt. As he dumped it out, he thought he saw something glisten as it fell into the dirt pile. Whatever it was quickly buried. Stanley stared at the pile a moment, unsure if he'd even seen it. Even if it was something, what good would it do to him? What good would it do him? He promised he'd give anything he found to X-Ray. It didn't seem worth the effort to climb out of his hole to check it out. He glanced up at the cloud, which was close enough to the sun that he had to squint to look at it. He dug his shovel back into the earth, scooped out some dirt, and lifted over his dirt pile. But instead of dumping it there, he tossed it off to the side. His curiosity had gotten the better of him. He climbed up out of his hole and sifted his fingers through the pile. He felt something hard and metallic. He pulled it out. It was a gold tube, about as long and as wide as the second finger on his right hand. The tube was open at one end and closed at the other. He used a few drops of his precious water to clean it. There seemed to be some kind of design on the flat, closed end. He poured a few more drops of water on it and rubbed it on the inside of his pants pocket. He looked again at the design engraved into the flat bottom of the tube. He could see an outline of a heart with the letter KB etched inside it. He tried to figure out some way that he wouldn't have to give it to X-Ray. He could just keep it, but then that wouldn't do him any good. He wanted a day off. He looked at the large piles of dirt near where X-Ray was digging. X-Ray was probably almost finished for the day. Getting the rest of the day off would hardly do him much good. X-Ray would first have to show the tube to Mr. Sir or Mr. Pendaski, who would then have to show it to the warden. By then, X-Ray might be done anyway. Stanley wondered about trying to secretly take the tube directly to the warden. He could explain the situation to the warden, and the warden might even make up an excuse for giving him the day off so X-Ray wouldn't suspect. He looked across the lake toward the cabin under the two oak trees. That place scared him. He'd been at Camp Green Lake for almost 2 weeks and still hadn't even seen the warden. That was just as well. If he can go his entire year and a half without seeing the warden, that would be fine with him. Besides, he didn't know if the warden would find the tube interesting. He looked at it again. It looked familiar. Thought he'd seen it, something like it, before, but he couldn't quite place it. What you got there, caveman? Asked Zigzag. Stanley's large hand closed around the tube. Nothing, it was useless. I think I might have found something else. Another fossil? No, I'm not sure what it is. Well, let me see, said Zigzag. Instead of showing it to Zigzag, Stanley brought it to X-Ray. Zigzag followed. X-Ray looked at the tube, then rubbed his dirty glasses on his dirty shirt and looked at the tube again. And one by one, the other boys dropped their shovels and came to look. It looks like an old shotgun shell, said Squid. Yeah, that's probably what it is, said Stanley. He decided not to mention the engraved design. Maybe nobody would notice it. He doubted X-Ray could see it. No, it's too long and thin to be a shotgun shell, said Magnet. It's probably just a piece of junk, said Stanley. Well, I'll show it to Mom, said X-Ray, see what he thinks. Who knows, maybe I'll get the day off. Your hole is almost finished, said Stanley. Yeah, so? Stanley raised and lowered his shoulder. So why don't you wait until tomorrow to show it to Mom, he suggested. You can pretend you found it first thing in the morning, then you can get the whole day off instead of just an hour or so this afternoon. X-Ray smiled. You're thinking, caveman. He dropped the tube into his large pocket on the right leg of his dirty orange pants. Stanley returned to his hole. When the water truck came, Stanley started to take his place at the end of the line, but X-Ray told him to get behind Magnet in front of Zero. Stanley moved up one place in line. Okay, so as you can see, he's starting to get more comfortable, but I'm noticing a trend. I hope you notice it too. The second hole is harder, the third hole is harder, the fourth hole is harder, the fifth hole is harder. I thought that was very interesting, so I wonder what the seventh hole and so on and so forth, what's going to happen to him. So anyways, I'm wearing a hat. You know, as you can see, I'm a big baseball fan, and my goal is to try to get most of the major league teams, but I refuse to get a Cardinals or a Cubs hat, and still thinking about whether I want a Dodgers hat or not, but we'll see, maybe. Anyways, I hope you guys are doing great. I really miss you guys. Your project is to do something about the Twins, and what does the TC stand for on the logo of the baseball cap, okay? Otherwise, that's pretty much it. Hope you guys are doing good. Love you guys. I'll talk to you guys soon. Bye-bye.